This clue revolves around one of the most remarkable men you may have never heard of, Richard E. Byrd, and his relationship with Antarctica and the secretive missions he carried out there until his dying day. The Reader's Digest version of Richard Byrd is as follows. Born in 1888, he became an American naval officer who specialized in feats of exploration. He was a pioneering American aviator, Medal of Honor winner, polar explorer, aircraft navigator, expedition leader in the worst environments in the world, and the youngest admiral in the history of the Navy. In addition, his list of awards takes up several pages in Wikipedia, including three ticker tape parades in his honor. In short, he was Indiana Jones on steroids. I mention all his accolades to paint a picture of credibility and trust. The governments of the United States and the world trusted his judgment and leadership, and took advantage of every chance they had to put him in charge of special missions. The first large-scale mission was an expedition to Antarctica in 1928. This was noteworthy because even though he had just flown over the North Pole in 1926, all expeditions from 1928 on were focused on the South. The expedition lasted 2 years, and during it, at the age of 41, he was promoted to admiral. His second Antarctic expedition ran from 1933 to 1935, and his third from 39 to 40. While in Antarctica, he was also an advisor for other countries who had their own expeditions, including England, France, Germany, and building off previous countries' expeditions from Belgium, Japan, and Sweden. He then helped lead U.S. Navy fleet operations in World War II, was present during the Japanese surrender in 1945, but then something strange happened. He went back to Antarctica. Now, some of you aren't surprised because he'd been there since 1928, and I agree with you. It's the how that's interesting here. His fourth trip to Antarctica wasn't an expedition. It was a military operation called Operation High Jump. Commanding an entire aircraft carrier group that included 13 support ships, Admiral Byrd led 4,700 men to the South Pole for reasons that are still shrouded to this day. Some say they were chasing the remaining Nazi fleet, even though Germany had surrendered a full year earlier. Others say there was a Nazi base established in Antarctica during the war, when Admiral Byrd was absent. None of these theories are important for this video. What we do know is that the U.S. had sent an excessively large military force to the ice, all under the guise of peaceful intentions. During this operation, Admiral Byrd told a Chile newspaper this: "The most important result of his observations and discoveries is the potential effect that they have in relation to the security of the United States. The fantastic speed in which the world is shrinking," recalled the admiral, "is one of the most important lessons learned during his recent Antarctic exploration. I have to warn my compatriots that the time has ended when we were able to take refuge in our own isolation and rely on the certainty that the distances, the oceans, and the poles were a guarantee of safety." After the operation, Admiral Byrd toured the States and gave interviews, the most interesting of which is a national television show in 1954 called The Long Eyes Chronoscope, a horrible name, but a decent show. During this television interview, he first spoke of an area beyond the South Pole as large as the United States, which no one had set foot on yet. He then went on to say that there would probably be expeditions year after year because the U.S. government had really become interested. The interviewers then probed as to why the interest in the South, when any perceived military threat from Russia, keep in mind this was 1954, would be from the North. He went on to say that it was the most valuable and important place in the world for science. It involved the future of the nation, an untouched reservoir of untapped resources, including coal, oil, minerals, and uranium. He added that at the time of the interview, there were seven nations currently engaged in Antarctica, including Russia, Australia, Argentina, Chile, and New Zealand. During the interview, the admiral talked about planning the next military mission to Antarctica. It was called Operation Deep Freeze and ran from 1955 to 1956. The mission was completed, and he supposedly returned home. Now, this is where you come in and say, so what? And normally I'd agree with you, except for what happened next. Nothing happened next. The missions just suddenly stopped, and that was it. No other expeditions, military or otherwise, were conducted on the continent, ever. Then a treaty was put in place, banning any country from doing basically anything. The end. And if you're wondering what you're missing, it's this. Admiral Byrd goes on television, says that this massive body of land, most of which sits on a plateau 2 miles high, is rich with every resource you could ever want, energy rich, pristine, with no indigenous population or plant life, and every country that has sent teams is ready to carve it up like a big turkey. Not to mention, there's an expanse of land larger than the United States they haven't even looked at yet. And out of the blue, everyone just calls the whole thing off? There are no environmentalists in 1959. So what happened? They found the edge, that's what. And the last thing they were going to do was let unsupervised companies near it, regardless of the money. Even if it was hundreds of miles away, you couldn't allow resource corporations, even into a safe area, and then years down the road as they expanded, tell them, oh, sorry, you can't go beyond this point. When the companies ask why, what would you tell them? And now the interior of Antarctica is off limits, with no revisions until the year 2041. You can take tours of the outer islands, but there is a hidden line, enforced by the military, that you will not be able to cross, because the interior is actually the exterior edge. It's there, it's hidden, and it's protected. The Earth you live on is flat.
The only thing I do know is that nothing flies over the South Pole, because again, on a flat map, the South Pole, the continent of Antarctica, is the ring around the Earth. So, you know, you can't fly over the ring and get anywhere. That's why we're not allowed to go there. I mean, think about it. It's the only treaty that all these countries have signed and never broken and completely agreed on. It's the only one. And, you know, what treaty is there that everybody's agreed on? We're being kept away from it for a reason. You know, they have some scientific bases there. Yeah, and literally, it's controlled by the military. If you try and go there by yourself, you will be sort of picked up and escorted back. There was a guy called Jarls Anderhoy who tried to take a mission to the Antarctica, and he was picked up and taken back by the military. It's a good reason because they don't want you finding out what's beyond. Admiral Byrd, he actually did four expeditions.
Aha, and četiri.
And most of them were military expeditions with huge military groups, thousands of people, you know, planes, boats, the works. And yes, he confirmed in an interview that he discovered a continent as big as the continental United States out there, that was with warm water lakes and mountains and everything, that was completely uninhabited. And he described it as the other side of the South Pole to Middle America. So on the globe, that means it would be somewhere in the Indian Ocean. There's a huge continent that nobody knows about. So there's more going on than meets the eye. The other thing is, after Admiral Byrd came back after his last expedition, Antarctica was sealed off, and both America and the Russians started firing nuclear missiles straight up. Now in America, that was called Operation Fishbowl, and it came under something called Project Dominic. Well, Fishbowl makes sense because it seems like Admiral Byrd found the edge of the dome, mm-hmm. Okay, while he was out there. And as soon as he left there, they started firing missiles straight up, I believe, to try and test how far that dome went. Mm-hmm. If you look at the footage of these explosions, what you'll see is an explosion. Well, when a bomb goes off in midair, it's a fireball. It expands in all directions and mostly up. Okay. Now, if you look at these explosions on Operation Fishbowl, they explode outwards in a ring, which means it's exploding against something because it can't rise with the heat. So it's exploding against something and exploding outwards. Okay. And the middle of the explosion, you'll see it glows, you know, hot, and then it cools over time. So it looks to me like they were exploding against a dome. Now, I said it was Operation Fishbowl, obviously Fishbowl, but there's a chap called Rob Skiber who discovered that the Project Dominic, the word Dominic means of the Lord, Fishbowl of the Lord. So I believe they clearly know that we're in an enclosed system, and Admiral Byrd found the edge, and they've tested to see how far it goes up.
For the past 500 years, we've been completely buying into the Copernicus heliocentric model. But what we do know about the flat Earth is based on the azimuthal equidistant map that seems to be working out. This map goes as far back as the year 1000 and possibly earlier, now used as an official map by the U.S. Geological Survey and also as the official logo for the United Nations. Is this our real home being hidden from us in plain sight? I think it is. The first thing a lot of people say is, where's the edge? Well, look at this map where Antarctica is a 360-degree ice barrier that holds the water in. These ice walls are real, and they stand 150 feet above the surface of the water. Then you need to understand that there is no independent access to Antarctica. Average people can only go there on a guided tour. It has no towns, no cities, and no permanent residences. What's past the 150-foot ice wall is anyone's guess. How far the ice extends, how it terminates, and what exists beyond it. The Antarctic Treaty, signed in 1959 by 12 nations and more later on, states that Antarctica is for peaceful purposes only. No military activities, just scientific research and government exploration. Expeditions by any party must be discussed in advance. It's the longest and most successful treaty between nations. The treaty also states that there are ships, stations, and equipment to ensure compliance of the treaty. Sounds like military activity to me. In a 1954 interview with Admiral Richard E. Byrd, an American naval officer who specialized in exploration, he had this to say.
But strangely enough, there's left in the world today an area as big as the United States that's never been seen by a human being. And that's beyond the pole on the other side of the South Pole from Middle America. And I think it's quite astonishing that there should be an area as big as that unexplored.
Implying that there is more land past Antarctica. If that uninhabited land was on a globe, it would be in the Indian Ocean.